Hi friends, a warm welcome to you all to the journey of understanding the concept of a check. Check is a concept which is attached with the banking system. So friends, first let's see the evolution of bank. According to some researchers, the term bank either derived from the old Italian word banca or from a French word banque. And both these words means a bench or a money exchange table. Friends, can you believe that in olden days in Europe, the money lenders used to display their coins on a table for lending and for exchange. And this was a bank in those days. But according to some authorities, the word bank itself is derived from the word bankus or banki. That is a bench. The Jews also had their exchange of money on the tables or benches. The history of banking leads us to the Middle Age Europe. The Chambers 20th century dictionary defines a bank as an institution for the keeping, lending and exchanging etc. of money. Later, the Banking Regulations Act 1949 defines bank as banking means the accepting for the purpose of lending or investments of deposits of money from the public repayable on demand or otherwise and withdrawable by check, draft and an order or otherwise. A bank provides different types of services to its individual as well as corporate clients. It acts as a payment system constituent, intermediary and a financial service provider. For facilitating the payment and remittance services, the basic instrument which is used is called as a check. Now friends, let me take you through a voyage of the origin of check. According to the research, during the 1st century AD, the banks in Persia and the surrounding areas issued letters of credit called as Akka checks, which are believed to be the basis of modern day checks. The London Goldsmith Bank was the first bank in England. The customers of this bank issued a note stating their requirement of paying the person said amount of money. The money was to be paid from the account of the sender to the presenter of the note and was called as a drawn note. The customer of the London Goldsmith Bank wrote an ordinary note on a piece of paper stating the amount which was to be paid to the bearer of the note or to the order of the bearer of the note. Like for example, if Mr. Thomas wanted to pay to Mr. Edmund amount of £12 on 16th August 1675, he would design a note stating, Mr. Thomas, I desire to pay Mr. Edmund, so pay unto the bearer of this note an amount of £12 and place it unto the account, your customer, Mr. Thomas. Thus, if Mr. Edmund or any other bearer of this note approached the bank, the banker took the note and paid him the said amount, showing it as a withdrawal from Mr. Thomas' account. In the 1700s, the first printed check was prepared. This was a common instrument which did not have account number. Thus, every account holder used the same printed instrument. Finally, in 1810, the first personalized printed check was started. This instrument contained the name of the account holder and the name of the banker. Other things like the date, name against which it had to be issued, and the amount had to be written by the drawer of the check. Thus, people started realizing that a drawn note was much more safer and easy for making the transactions than transacting the cash. So the drawn notes started gaining importance. Later, the drawn notes were called as cheques. It became a negotiable instrument and was also included in the Negotiable Instrument Act 1881. The Section 6 of this Act defines the cheque as: a cheque is a bill of exchange drawn on a specified banker and is expressed to be payable only on demand. The person who draws a cheque is called as a drawer, and the person on whom the cheque is drawn is called as a drawee. In the modern days, the cheques are provided in specified formats. According to the Reserve Bank of India RBI guidelines, a cheque needs to have specified details like date. The date on the cheque is given in the format of days, months, years. The cheque is valid for 3 months from the date of the issue. Name to whom the cheque is to be paid, drawee name. The drawee's name indicates to the banker as to whom the cheque needs to be paid. The name can be a person's name or a name of a company. The amount of the cheque is deposited in his account mentioned on the cheque. Amount in figures and in words. This is the most important part of the cheque, which needs to be carefully filled by the drawer. The amount is written in figures as well as words. The amount in figures is written in a box mentioned on the cheque with the rupee sign. After writing the required amount, the drawer ends the amount with a slash and a hyphen sign. This indicates that the amount written has been ended and it would avoid frauds. The same amount is written in words, and at the end, the drawer needs to add the word only, so as to indicate that the amount written has been ended. Account number of the drawer. The account number of the drawer is printed on the check. Name and address of the drawer's bank. The name and address of the drawer's bank is mentioned on the check. This indicates the name and branch from where the check has been drawn. An IFSC or the Indian Financial System Code is an 11-digit in alphanumeric format used by the Reserve Bank of India to identify all the bank branches within the NEFT network, NEFT, National Electronic Fund Transfer. In the 11-character code, the first 4 alphabetic characters represent the bank name, and the last 6 characters, usually numeric but can be alphabetic, represent the branch. The 5th character, which is a 0, and it is reserved for future use. Pantograph. When photocopied by a colored copier, the word void appears on the copied document. A document with a void pantograph is more difficult to duplicate than one with a standard pantograph. In other words, it's a simplified fraud avoidance design to deter and decrease the counterfeit checks. CTS India watermark. It is a watermark present on each check, which helps the faster clearance of checks. CTS is basically an online image check clearance system where check images and magnetic ink character recognition, that is MICR data, are captured at the collecting bank branch and transmitted electronically. This stops the flow of physical checks issued by the drawer to the drawee branch. MICR number. Many of you would have seen the magnetic ink barcodes printed on the bottom of your bank check leaves. These barcodes are known as MICR codes, an abbreviation for magnetic ink character recognition. Actually, the MICR is the name given to the technology used in printing the code. It is a 9-digit numeric code where each 3 digits signify some important information about the bank and the transaction. The first 3 digits of MICR represent the city code, which indicates the city in which the bank branch is located. In most of the cases, it is the first 3 numbers of the PIN code. Like for Delhi, the first 3 numbers are going to be 110. The next 3 digits represent the bank code, that is the identity of the bank. And the last 3 digits represent the bank branch code, that is the identity of the location of the bank branch. For example, if the MICR number on the check is 110229003, it means 110 city code Delhi, 229 bank code ICICI Bank, 003 bank branch code Gurgaon. Name and signature of the drawer. The name of the drawer or the authorized signatory is mentioned on the check. The person has to sign the check before issuing it to the drawee. The signature is tallied with the specimen signature with the bank before paying the money. The drawer of the check needs to sign above the name. The signature should not enter the magnetic ink strip. RBI also specifies the dimensions of the check leaflet. For knowing the dimensions, friends, please refer to the academic script of the lecture. Friends, do you know there are 14 types of checks? Now, we shall discuss some of those 14 types of checks which we use in daily routine life. First type, order check. A check which is payable to a particular person or his order is called as an order check. This is a check whereby the printed words bearer on the check is cancelled. The cancellation of the word bearer automatically makes the check an order check. An order check can be paid to the named payee across the bank's account if so presented. Bearer check. A check which is payable to a person who bears it is called bearer check. The check sometimes can be made payable in cash to the bearer or made payable to a specific name. This check is payable by the drawee bank over the counter to the bearer or presenter of the check. A bearer check can be negotiated or passed to another person by mere delivery. In other words, the holder or the transferor giving it to another person need not endorse the check. No identification is needed when a bearer check is presented for encashment. However, in normal banking practice where the amount of the check is substantial, the identity of the encasher is insisted on. A bearer check can be collected by the bank for the credit of anyone's account. In banking practice, the need for the encasher's signature on the back of the check is merely to evidence that the encasher has received the money from the bank. Blank check. A check on which the drawer puts a signature and leaves all other columns blank is called as a blank check. The check that is signed by the payer but with no specific amount indicated, leaving it to the drawee. Generally, such checks are given to those on whom the drawer has very high amount of trust. Stale check. A check presented at the paying bank after a certain period, typically 3 months, of its payment date is called as a stale check. A stale check is not an invalid check. A bank may refuse to honor it unless the drawer reconfirms the payment either by inserting a new payment date or by issuing a new check. It is called as a stale dated check. Now, the check which is more than 3 months old is a stale check. The Banking Regulation Act has not defined specific period after which the instrument, that is check, becomes stale. Some of the banks write specific instructions on the check where the validity period is mentioned. In such cases, the check will become stale after expiry of the period from the date of the issue of check. Mutilated check. If a check is torn into two or more pieces, such check is a mutilated check. If it is presented for payment, the bank will not make payment against such a check without getting confirmation from the drawer. In case if a check is torn at a corner and no material factors erased or cancelled, the bank may make payment against such a check. If the payee is clear, signature and the MICR line intact, they can process it. Postdated check. If a check bears a date later than the date of issue, it is termed as a postdated check. Any check or draft that has a future date written upon it by the user, the amount of the check will not be drawn from the account until the date written on the check. For example, Mr. Shekhar issues a check to Mr. Anil worth rupees 50,000 on 21st May 2016. As money needs to be paid to Mr. Anil on 1st July for a bill due on that date. But as a check needs to be issued on 21st May, a check is written but dated as 1st July. So, the check will not be cashed till 1st July. Cross check. When two parallel transverse lines with or without any words are drawn generally on the left hand top corner of the check, it is called as a cross check. Crossing does not affect the negotiability of the instrument. Crossing makes the check safer by preventing payment of the check in cash. Crossing is a direction given to the paying banker to make payment of the same only to another banker through clearing. It ensures that the payment is not made across the counter. It also helps in tracing out the payee through the collecting banker in case of a fraud. And it gives the drawer more time to stop the payment of the check. The check can be crossed by the drawer or any subsequent holder if the payee or the subsequent endorsee or the collecting banker crosses the check, it is not considered as an altered check. There are four types of crossing of a check. They are general crossing, special crossing, restrictive crossing, non-negotiable crossing. General crossing. There are four types of general crossing again. When only two parallel transverse lines are drawn on the left corner of the check, with or without the words and company, it indicates that the check has been marked to specify an instruction about the way it is to be redeemed. A common instruction is that it must be deposited directly into an account with a bank and not immediately cashed by the bank over the counter. When two parallel transverse lines are drawn on the left corner of the check with the words account pay, this crossing means that the amount of this check will reach the account of the drawee and cannot be encashed at a branch counter. When two parallel transverse lines are drawn on the left corner of the check with the words not negotiable, it indicates that the amount of the check cannot be cashed at the counter, but it will be deposited in the account of the drawee. Now, let's see special crossing. When a particular bank's name is written in between the two parallel lines, the check is said to be specially crossed. The effect of special crossing is that the bank makes payment only to the banker whose name is written in the crossing. Specially cross checks are more safe than generally cross checks. When the crossing is done by writing a name of a bank in between the lines, the banker needs to make the payment only to the bank specified. When the crossing contains the name of the bank as well as the words "and company" written, it indicates that the banker can make a payment in a specified bank as well as its subsidiaries. When the crossing is done by not only writing the name of the bank but also writing "account pay" in between the lines, the banker needs to make the payment only to the bank specified and only in the specified payee's account. When the crossing contains the name of the bank as well as the words "not negotiable" in between the two lines, it indicates that the banker needs to make the payment only to the specific bank and the check cannot be endorsed ahead. Now let's learn the concept of endorsement of check. An endorsement is a mode of transferring the check from one person to another without encashing the instrument in between. The person who endorses the check is called as an endorser. The person to whom the check is endorsed is called as an endorsee. The word endorsement is said to have been derived from Latin word "en" means upon and "dorsum" means the back. Thus, usually the endorsement is on the backside of the instrument, though it may be even on the face of it. When no space is left on the instrument, the endorsement may be made on a slip of paper attached to it. This attached slip of paper is called as analog. There are 5 types of endorsement. Let's see them in detail. First, blank endorsement. If the endorser signs in his name only, the endorsement is said to be a blank endorsement and it becomes payable to bearer. For example, if the endorser of the check, that is Mr. Amit, signed the instrument but did not mention any name as to whom the check needs to be endorsed, it can be made payable to the bearer of the check. So it is termed as a blank endorsement. Special or full endorsement. An endorsement in full or a special endorsement is one where endorser not only puts his signature on the instrument but also writes the name of a person to whom or to whose order the payment is to be made. For example, when Mr. Amit, the endorser, signs the check and writes the name Mr. Suresh on the check, then this check can be made payable only to Mr. Suresh. So it is called as special or full endorsement. Conditional endorsement. In conditional endorsement, the endorser puts his signature under such a writing which makes the transfer of title subject to fulfillment of some condition or of the happening of some events. For example, Mr. Kiran, the endorser of the check, signs the check and puts a condition that only after his marriage transfer the amount to Mr. Joshi. So in this case, the check will be endorsed only after Mr. Joshi's marriage. Thus, it is called as a conditional endorsement. Restrictive endorsement. An endorsement is called restrictive when the endorser restricts or prohibits further negotiation. Example, when Mr. Puneet, the endorser of the check, signs the check and writes "Miss Priya only," it indicates that the amount has to be transferred to Miss Priya. Thus, it is called as a restrictive endorsement. Partial endorsement. In partial endorsement, only a part of the amount of the bill is transferred or the amount of the bill is transferred to 2 or more endorsees. This is done when the part of the bill has to be paid to one party and remaining to other party. But this is not done in case of checks or bank drafts. Now friends, let's see how this theoretical knowledge of checks can be used to solve the practical situations. Mr. Lalit wants to pay his creditor, Mr. Sunil, an amount of ₹20,000, but wants to check that the amount is directly deposited in his account in Bank of India. We can analyze the situation as, in this situation, Mr. Lalit wants to draw a check for Mr. Sunil for ₹20,000, but the check must be such that the money will be directly deposited in Sunil's account. So, Mr. Lalit does not want to give him cash. Solution: the special crossing type where in the name of the bank and the words account payee are mentioned in between the two lines of crossing can be used. Thus, Mr. Lalit will draw a check on Mr. Sunil for ₹20,000 by putting a special crossing, that is, specifying the name of the bank, Bank of India, and mentioning the words account payee. Situation number 2. Mr. Shubham has to pay his tenant Mr. Shyam the deposit amount of 50,000 only after he vacates the apartment. He is planning to endorse the check received by him from Mr. Barve. Analysis: in this situation, Mr. Shubham is the landlord and has to pay his tenant Mr. Shyam after the fulfillment of a condition, that is, after the tenant vacates his apartment. But further, he is not going to pay from his own account, but he is going to endorse the check received by him. Thus, for solving this problem, he can take help of conditional endorsement. Solution: the check received by Mr. Shubham can be endorsed to Mr. Shyam using conditional endorsement as a tool. Mr. Shubham can sign on the check of ₹50,000 received from Mr. Barve and write a condition while signing that the check will be endorsed only after Mr. Shyam vacates the apartment. So, friends, by now you must have understood the usefulness of checks. Hope you enjoyed the journey through the world of checks. Thank you for being patient listeners. Bye, friends.